Today's topic is seeing the future. So timing is when you get the right product just when the customers want that product. Luck is when you hit them, not just hit the timing, but those customers have some opportunity that you can grab or see for some reason. You get posted on someone's system like Facebook or Twitter, or in this case, Quora. And all of a sudden, all these customers just show up unexpectedly without you having to pay for them. So let's talk about WeWork. So this company got started 6 or 7 years ago, and it failed, right? I mean, it hasn't totally failed yet, but it will soon. So what happened, right? Here's the reasons why things fail. Here's the reasons why things succeed. Why did this company fail? And I want to go a little deeper into this one because it's a really nice little case study as we look at all these other companies out there, including the ones we've invested in now. How are they likely to fail? And can we fix that? Right? That's the part of the accelerator that I love, which is if we see a flaw coming, if we see a hurdle coming, sometimes we can just go around the hurdle or we can avoid it altogether. So we're going kind of bottom up on the success side. So did WeWork have funding? They had a lot of funding. If you don't know the statistics, they had over $11 billion of investment before they tried to do their IPO, right? And then they got more money after that. This is a company that epitomizes overfunding, if anything else. So that was, proves that that's not sufficient. And it shows that too much funding can be a big problem as well. Did they have the right team? No, absolutely not. So they had a CEO who was charismatic, who could raise money, who could talk investors into giving him money, private investors into giving him money. And they gave him lots of money. But not only did they give him money, they let him have control of the company, complete control of the company, to the point where he had to give permission to get himself fired. That was a massive failure. None of the investors should have let that happen. They should never have invested unless he gave them enough power to have some control over what was going on, some oversight. How about luck? Well, yeah, this company had an enormous stroke of luck, a few strokes of luck. So if you read the backstory, which you need to be cynical when you read the backstories because sometimes they rewrite them. But from what I've heard on podcasts and in articles, there were two guys in New York and they were doing something, but not quite this. And they came across an investor who had too much money, who liked them. And so Adam spun them this story about this co-working space. And the guy wrote him like a $20 million check or $10 million check on this idea. Way too much money, way too quickly, didn't get to prove it out. So this one investor gave him a stamp of approval, gave him enough money to get a really nice space built, and then another and another. And it was a few years into it that they went and pitched SoftBank. And it was something, and the stories go that it was like a 15, 20 minute pitch. And that got them, the first check, which turned into $11 billion, two or three checks later. None of these investors did enough due diligence. I'm going to teach you guys how to do that. These investors did not. They just, if we scroll, I'm not going to flip it backwards, but if we went back to that vision versus reality pictures, they believed in the vision. Adam spun a vision that the investors believed wholeheartedly. He didn't have it yet, but he showed them a path that they believed would happen, and he lucked out and he got huge investors to dump the money in. And without that, the company would never have made the newspaper. How about timing? Did this company have the right timing? Well, yeah, in fact, they did for a while. So there's this movement that you missed if you haven't been an investor for the past 15 years, that companies used to raise money from private investors for like three rounds at most. And then they would go public for the fourth round. And that was the norm before the dot-com bubble. That was the norm as the dot-com bubble like came out of depression. And then it stopped being the norm 15-ish years ago for a variety of reasons. And so you've seen this. Facebook was 10 years old before they had their IPO. And Google even was pretty old. They were like 8 years old before they did their IPO. And Slack and Zoom and these other companies that have done their IPOs lately, they're doing like Series E, Series F before they do their IPOs. So they caught this wave at just the right moment that it was possible to raise $11 billion before an IPO. That was impossible 20 years ago. They also caught this wave of freelancers and coffee shop startups and everything as a service, month to month rent as a service, space as a service. And we have wireless everywhere now, and we're all carrying laptops, and we're all carrying mobile phones. Everything's mobile. Your office is your backpack. And they were early in the co-working space. They didn't invent it, but they were early in this co-working space, and they grabbed all this wave of market timing and built out, and the money, and built out this amazing network of co-working spaces. Nobody says the product's wrong. The business was wrong. So going back, right, what about the money? Well, despite all this, they overspent on growth. Literally, they were within a month of bankruptcy. Runway is how much time you can run your company before you're out of cash. They were a month away of running out of cash when they were doing the roadshow on the IPO. If the IPO failed, which it did, there were only two choices for this company. One was bankruptcy the next month, and the other one was a bailout by one of their investors. They got the bailout, but they were inches away from just being bankrupt. That's not good timing. They didn't have to do that. Nobody forced them to do that. They could have had 6 months or 9 months or 12 months of runway. They had enough money to plan that out. They chose the wrong plan. In terms of the market, yeah, they got the market right. There was a clear market need. Before the pandemic, at least, there was a clear market need for co-working spaces. They had no shortage of customers. They had retail customers, they had commercial customers, they had plenty of customers. And in terms of competition, they were the clear leader in the space. There's lots of competition in the co-working space, but there's no other global network like theirs that's doing co-working like them. The next nearest in size is a company called Regus, but it's a very different business doing office space rent month to month in a very different style. Did they get the price right? Yeah, I think so. So they were competitive with every other co-working space. They bought a lot of market share by giving away a lot of membership. So first month free, first 6 months office free, right? They spent that money on buying market share, all that cash they had. But in terms of pricing, in terms of picking the price that makes them a business, the answer is no. So it didn't matter how many members they had. It didn't matter if every single one of their spaces was completely full. They were still going to lose money because they didn't charge enough given how much they were spending on expenses, how much they were spending on building out their spaces, how much they were spending on endless kombucha on tap for every member. That part they got wrong. And the root cause of this failure, and it hasn't failed yet again, but it will. The root cause of this failure is that the business never actually penciled out. And you might hear me say that term a lot. Penciled out means when you run the quick financial plan, or the full-on financial plan, doesn't matter. If you run a financial plan for the company, if you can't make it profitable on paper, then it doesn't pencil out. If you can't do it on paper, you're never going to do it in real life. In real life, your revenues are always lower and your expenses are always higher. And so root cause of this company, they had a great product at just the right time and just the right place, and they ran it too expensively. And there was a guy in charge who just never understood that because people would just throw money at him. Now, even if that wasn't true, back to this map of today, even if he ran the company great and they had a successful IPO last year, well, who saw this coming? This is going to devastate the entire co-working space. No co-working company can afford to keep paying the rent for the next, I don't know, 3, 4, 5, 6 months and have no paying customers because the membership at co-working spaces is month to month with no need to sign a lease. So all the co-working spaces are going to lose their members come April 1st, and that's the end of the co-working companies for now. They'll pop back up again. They're easy to start up.